worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. He has done great things.
Restored by the river that
on up to the mountain of mercy, to the crimson perpetual tide. Kneel down on the shore, be thirsty no more, go under and be purified. Yeah. is keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are.
Good evening, folks. Welcome to Wednesday night Bible study. We have arrived once again at Passion Week, and it just so happens to be this evening as well. The Passover begins at sundown, but tonight we would, in our study, we'd like to look at the final words of Jesus on the cross. Also, we're going to conclude with communion. So as we tried to give you a heads up before, if you need to get some crackers and wafers or some bread, whatever it is that you might use for communion along with some juice, hopefully you already have that at hand. And so we have a selection of different scriptures. We have three references from Luke 23, three references from John chapter 19, and also one from Matthew chapter 27. So we're going to be jumping around quite a bit. So as we begin, let's have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you. Thank you that you sent your Son. Lord, we rejoice in the fact that, Lord, you have redeemed us. Lord, you went to the cross. Lord, you paid the sin debt for mankind, whosoever would believe. Thank you, Lord, that you became our substitute. Lord, you took our punishment. And in exchange, Lord, you grant to us grace and mercy. Lord, relationship with you and eternal life. So, Lord, we are grateful as we once again come to this Passion Week and, Lord, celebrate, Lord, your resurrection. Lord, we pray that you bless your study, Lord, the study of your word. And we thank you, Lord, for the things that you spoke from the cross, that they're relevant, Lord, and they're important. They speak to us today. So we commit this evening to you. Lord, bless our time, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. I don't know what you have you ever thought about what your last words would be to those whom you love. This is something perhaps I have rehearsed in my mind, at least, some of the things that I would say. Maybe things perhaps that we feel uncomfortable maybe saying, but knowing that perhaps maybe our life isn't much longer, there may be some important things we'd want to say. And of course, as we look at the words of Jesus here, they're very critical, they're very important. They fulfill prophecy, They also, too, they convey power. There's always power in His truth, but also, too, they're practical. They speak to us about issues in our own life. I would imagine many people go through their life and there are things that maybe they need to say that they feel they can't say. And I think that because we have the Spirit of God, you know, in our lives, that we can, that He can enable us to say the things that we need to say. We don't need to wait to our deathbed, but the fact is we have opportunity here and now to say the things to those that we, to those whom we love. And important things. I think it's important when we consider what is the legacy that we leave behind. And of course, our Lord, He leaves a rich legacy for us. And our first reference in this sequence is Luke 23, verse 33 and 34. I'll just read those to you. It says, "And when they had come to the place called Calvary, there they crucified Him and the criminals, one on the right hand, the other on the left. And then Jesus said, 'Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do.' And they divided His garments and cast lots." And when we consider this kind of forgiveness, this is supernatural. This is not any kind of, you know, we talk about forgiveness and we have a certain kind of forgiveness, but it's not the kind of forgiveness that we need to have in an ongoing way, in a consistent way, in a loving way, in a meaningful way. Sometimes people will say they forgive us, but they really don't. Maybe we've said that to them as well. But here is a supernatural kind of forgiveness that we see in the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's a forgiveness, you know, that is said even in the event that He is being murdered. And think about that, you know, someone trying to hurt you, trying to harm you. Could you forgive them for that? You know, I've even witnessed Christians unwilling to forgive sometimes, even for the slightest unintentional, you know, offense and things that are maybe said in an unintentional kind of a way. And we know that forgiveness is a challenging thing. It's very difficult for us. And this kind of forgiveness that we see here of our Lord is a radical forgiveness. It's not available to everybody, but it's available to those that will trust Him and to look to Him. You know, Paul reminds us that we are forgiven. We're called to forgive because we have been forgiven. Actually, a great debt. Jesus has a number of parables relative to the matter of forgiveness, that we have been forgiven a tremendous debt against the Lord. And because of that, we have no right to hold someone in an unforgiving kind of a way. So here He says, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do," which is kind of interesting because their putting Him to death was very intentional, but the fact is they really didn't understand who they were attempting to murder. They had put God on the cross, and no doubt they were obviously ignorant in their doing of that. Now, we want to also, too, look at Luke 23, 42 and 43. And we're told here, again, this is a sort of a connected also to the previous reference. And then He said to Jesus, verse 42, speaking here of one of the thieves on the cross, one of the criminals. He says, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus said to him, "Assuredly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." And what we see here, interestingly, is a conversion taking place, and then later there would obviously be other conversions. But here, redemption is already taking place as Christ is not even off the cross. He's still on the cross, and redemption is taking place around Him. And Paul said that the cross, you know, the sacrificial offering of the Lord, offering Himself in our place as our substitute, taking our punishment, our judgment, and in exchange giving us His grace, giving us forgiveness and mercy, that Paul says the message of the cross is a very powerful message because of what it basically provides for you and I and for any who will receive the forgiveness that the cross offers. Verse 18 of 1 Corinthians chapter 1, Paul writes this, "For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing." And how true that is. People think, well, you know, what can some man dying accomplish for me? But he's not just some man. He's the God-man. And of course, this was all part of his plan that he had purposed from the foundation of the world, how he would redeem mankind after we had fallen. But again, maybe even yourself as a Christian, if you can remember, hearing the gospel, thinking, well, how does that maybe relate to me, or what does that really mean? How do I interpret that in a personal kind of a way? And of course, we find that the Holy Spirit is the one who helps us to interpret that in our particular life. But he goes on to say here, "But to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." So again, his sacrifice, it pays our sin debt. He takes our place. The cross was really, in a sense, the capital punishment. And it was a capital punishment that every person who has sinned against God, and we all have sinned, that we're deserving of that kind of capital punishment. And so when you think about the grace of God, the mercy of God coming, in our stead to take our place, I mean, it's absolutely incredible when you think about how awesome God's plan and purpose is to save mankind, to reach out, to save us, because he knew that we couldn't save ourselves. There's no way that we could ever arrive at any kind of moral perfection or goodness where we could be forgiven in ourselves. It's a wonderful grace and gift of God that he would offer to you and I. And, when you think about God's power here, Paul speaks about in verse 18. He reminds us also to in another place, it's God's power displayed in weakness. Here is God saving us, the most incredibly redemptive, the most powerful act of all humanity, that it's taking place as he is being crucified on the cross. It's taking place, transpiring in absolute weakness. And Paul reminds us that of the weakness. We see God oftentimes, the grace of God displayed even in our own life when it comes to this matter of weakness. And so again here, this marvelous grace that we see, given. He says, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus says back to him, "Assuredly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. So again, this grace goes to anyone who will turn to Christ. And what I love about this scenario here with the thief on the cross, and again, it reminds me of the marvelous grace of it, because here, this man who has no hopes of escaping his judgment, that this is the final moments of his life, the grace of God is reaching out to him at this particular time. And again, regardless of the fact that is that he lived a horrible life, a wicked life, he was a criminal. And it reminds us too that it's never too late. It's never too late to turn to Christ. No matter, I've heard people say this kind of thing, where they've lived their whole life without Christ, and here they're dying, and they're presented with the gospel, and they feel that it's somewhat hypocritical, to turn to the Lord in the last moments of their life. And it's sort of like a final lifesaver that God is throwing out to this particular person. But pride is one of those kind of things that will keep someone, from being saved and giving their life to the Lord, even though it may be, that final opportunity to open up their life to him. The Bible says today's the day of salvation. It's never too late. Now is the appointed time. So whenever a person senses the grace of God coming out to you in any kind of way, take hold of that. That's a great opportunity to receive redemption and forgiveness and cleansing. Now I want you to turn over to John 19, our other references here. And I would like to entitle this little piece here, Family Matters, because here's the Lord on the cross, and he's thinking of his mother, he's thinking of his family. And we're told in 19:26 of John's Gospel that Jesus, therefore, as he's on the cross, he saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing by, and he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." So here he is on the cross with all of his suffering taking place, and he's considered, you know, the future care of his mother. And here's John, the disciple, and John would always refer to himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved, didn't want to mention his name. But, and again, I think here it's just sort of noteworthy of the love that Christ has to take care of his mother, you know, even in this situation. We don't know how many were with her and in the family at that particular point. But he says here to the disciple, to John, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, that disciple took her to his own home. So again, here, Jesus, having no material wealth, you know, passing on, you know, to his family or to his mother, yet he makes full provision to her through John. And again, you know, the Bible exhorts us many different times to take care, you know, to love our parents, to honor them, you know, to care for the elderly, to reach out to them. And I think that's very important for us, and see how important it was for Jesus, you know, at this particular point. You know, I think in many different ways, modern society has neglected our responsibility to our parents. We don't have to look far to see that. And there may be many reasons for that. There may be some justification. I do not know. But I think it's important the Bible enjoins us and calls us to do that. Now, we're still in John 19, but we're in verse 28. The next thing that Jesus says here is knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, he said, "I thirst." Now, this is the fulfillment of Psalm 22. I'll read Psalm 22 to you. And Psalm 22, if you're familiar with it, Psalm 22, along with Isaiah 53, they're portraits of the suffering Messiah. The thing I like about Psalm 22, it's spoken in the first person. Isaiah 53, a beautiful piece of scripture, a portrait of the suffering Savior. That is spoken by the prophet in the third person, but Psalm 22 here is in the first person. And it's the very first two verses that we find, verses 14 and 50 that we find here relative to Jesus' suffering and his being thirsty, where it says in verse 14, I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint, and my heart is like wax. It has melted within me. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue clings to my jaws, and you have brought me into the dust of death. So we can only imagine that kind of thirst. There's been only a few times in my life where I've been extremely thirsty and without water, and I can remember how difficult that is. And here we see here what Jesus endured in his scourging, his crucifixion, the loss of blood, the depletion of every kind of bodily fluid, his collapsing body at this particular point, and he's craving for water. We can't even begin to imagine this. But, you know, when you think about what he endured, what he suffered for you and I, he became thirsty that you and I might drink from the water of life. I was thinking about one of the final references over in Revelation 22. And the Lord is speaking here in verse 16. Jesus is speaking there, and then in verse 17 here, and again, this is the one of the final things that are said, welcoming people and, you know, inviting people into eternity in Revelation 22. It says, "And the Spirit and the bride say, 'Come.' Let him who hears say, 'Come.' Let him who thirsts, come. Whoever desires, let him take of the water of life freely." And what a wonderful thing that is. But, you know, that's available now. So often life, where we find ourselves hungry, we find ourselves, you know, the Bible speaks about that, that man has a hunger. We have a thirst as well, a thirst that no matter what we try to eat or what we try to drink, we can never really be satisfied. But there's a satisfaction that comes, you know, from knowing Christ. And you can only experience this once he comes into your life. And we have to open our lives up to him. We have to open our heart up to him, to allow him to fill that void, to settle that, to quench that thirst, and to, you know, to satisfy that hunger deep within our hearts and deep within our lives. And so he thirsted again so that, that we might be filled, that we might experience refreshment as we come to him and to partake of that water of life. You know, over in one of the Psalms, it says, "Taste and see that the Lord is good." And it's only as you taste and see and receive him into your life can you really appreciate and understand what it is to be satisfied on that kind of level. Now hold your place there in John chapter 19, and I want you to turn to Matthew 27. And Matthew 27, verse 45. And I don't think anybody has ever felt so forsaken, so abandoned, and so alone. And you know, when we think about this, the Lord Jesus Christ, when you study his life, you look and you come to realize he experienced everything in his humanity in the sense that you and I go through. He's experienced it to the point, except for sin. And ultimately, he experiences that too on the cross, because Paul tells us that he became sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in Christ. But he never practiced sin like you and I practice. And so as we come to verse 45 and 46 of Matthew 27, the end is drawing near at this point. It's the ninth hour. There's darkness all over the land. And we're told in verse 46, about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," that is, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Now, this is Psalm 22, verse 1. You know that from reading that psalm. And of course, when you think about a psalm, this is a song. And what a difficult song. And of course, I was thinking about how so many songs today are to entertain people. But oftentimes, when we look at the Psalms, which were all songs, the largest book in the Bible is a songbook, and many of these songs are you know, written from a very visceral kind of experience, a very difficult kind of experience that song was born out of. Sometimes, you know, sometimes we do get a song that has been born out of you know, suffering or difficulty, and we kind of can relate to that song, or maybe that song might draw a tear to our eye. But when you look at the Psalms and the songs of the Bible, they're very instructional. And here we have Psalm 22, Jesus quoting that, and of course David, even though he felt he was forsaken, you know, by God, he was not. And of course he was speaking prophetically about the Lord Jesus Christ. And again, here, we see this as a question. And the answer to this question is, my God, why have you forsaken me? Is that you and I might be accepted. He was forsaken. He was abandoned in a sense. He suffered all this. And that's what I love about the Lord. No matter what it is you and I can go through. And there may be somebody that you're watching this tonight and you're lonely. And of course, we are separated in this corona crisis. One of the things that I was texting somebody who was touching base with me by way of text yesterday, I was reminded of Romans chapter 8, that nothing is able to separate us from the love of Christ. Yes, we may be separated by distance, separated by our circumstances, but we're not separated from him. And because our Lord Jesus Christ, he became separated in that sense, forsaken, you know, by the Father for those moments, for that time that you and I, you know, might be accepted. And of course, we know the Lord, he can truly feel our suffering. You know, sometimes people say, I feel your suffering. We can maybe relate to people, but sometimes we really can't feel their suffering, but the Lord can. And that's why I think it's important, you know, when we're suffering, when we're going through difficulty, we need to turn to him. David said at one point, "I pour out my heart before him." We need to do that. We need to learn how to do that, to interface with Him and interact with Him. That's what prayer is about. I think when our prayer life is not what it should be, that I think we're missing a whole dimension in our relationship with the Lord. To interface with Him, to talk with Him, to pour out our heart, to have Him speak back to us, you know, through the Scripture. Very important. Now back to John chapter 19, and we want to pick this up in verses 29 and verse 30. It says, "Now a vessel full of sour wine was sitting there, and they filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on hyssop, and put it to his mouth. And so when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, 'It is finished.' And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit." And of course, we know that he did that willingly. And so in finality, he declares here that his mission of redemption is accomplished. Satan's power now will be broken over mankind. You know, he says over in John chapter 4, verse 34, he says, "My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work." And so now that finished work of redemption, a plan that had been planned before the foundation of the world. It wasn't a mistake. The Lord was in perfect control. At one point, he says, "No one takes my life from me, but I give it. I offer it willingly." And again, his work was to do the will of the Father. Our work is this, is simply to believe. To believe, I think it's John chapter 6, verse 29. We're to believe on him whom the Father has sent. And nothing we can do other than that. No way we can earn it. No way we can accomplish it by just simply, it's by faith, it's by believing in him. Our final reference is Luke 23, 44, if you'll turn there. And it reads like this, "Now it was about the sixth hour, and there was darkness over all the earth for three entire hours, until the ninth hour, and then the sun was darkened, and the veil of the temple was torn in two by an earthquake. And when he had cried out with a loud voice, he said, 'Father, into your hands I commit my spirit.' And having said this, he breathed his last." So this final expression of Jesus is just one of total, absolute trust. When we look at these events, they were not happenstance. It wasn't an accident. Men were not controlling these events. As a matter of fact, Peter in Acts chapter 2, preaching on the day of Pentecost, he said this, speaking of Christ in verse 23, chapter 2, he says, "Him, being delivered by the determined purpose and the foreknowledge of God, you, the people, have taken by lawless hands and have crucified and put to death whom God raised up." So you see there, you know, the sovereign purpose of God being worked out. Also, do you see human responsibility in that same particular verse? And when you look at the events that surround this, they had to be evidence, the phenomenon taking place here, an earthquake, the sun being darkened in the sky, and we're told all the earth, this darkness came upon. And, you know, for 3 hours, an earthquake taking place, the veil of the temple being torn. Later on, the resurrection, saints, Old Testament saints, being resurrected and walking around the streets of Jerusalem. And again, this phenomenon simply had to be evidence to those that were observing, to those who would have an open heart, and no doubt they would encourage the believing heart. And when you see these final words of Jesus in 46, they're words of complete surrender. Complete surrender. They're taken from Psalm 31, verse 5. And I think they encourage us that no matter what the circumstances are in our life, that the Lord also too can give us that kind of a heart, that kind of a mindset, where we can be surrendered, committed, you know, to the Lord, even though situations we may not like, they may be difficult in that sort of thing. But the fact of the matter is that He can give us that same kind of heart, that same kind of mentality as we see being played out here, you know, with our Lord Jesus Christ. And so it says, having said this, he breathed his last. And so I see two different stories being taking place here. There's one of rebellion, there's one of resistance, and there's one of complete submission. And that much of life is like that. You know, we here, you know, before the cross were just a handful of people that were submitted, brokenhearted, but submitted to this whole situation. And yet there were those who were resisting and fighting. And the fact of the matter is, even those that were resisting and rebelling against, you know, the one who was on the cross, hanging on the cross, that he was forgiving them, that he had died equally for them as he had for his chosen little group there at the foot of the cross. And so I think that, you know, submission is one of those things that we come to learn that, you know, initially I think we learn to surrender our life to the Lord, and we're grateful and we're thankful for what he's done, but sometimes we tend to take our lives back. And so you come to find out as you walk with the Lord for any length of time that he wants us to completely surrender ourselves to him. And I'm going to ask you, what about you tonight? Does that speak of your life? Is there an area of your life maybe that you need to surrender to him? You need to submit to him. You need to turn over the steering wheel, the control of your life, because oftentimes the decisions that we make, you can get us into perplexity, can get us into difficulty and trouble. They're decisions of our own making. You know, we so often we operate, you know, by the wisdom of the world, and God's wisdom is so totally different. And that's why Paul speaks about that in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. You know, in the wisdom of the world, they put Christ on the cross. But in God's wisdom, in allowing that whole thing to take place, he was redeeming people at the same time. So his wisdom is so completely different from yours and from mine. So as we, I'm going to ask you to get out those elements of communion if you're partaking with us tonight. And we have the bread and we have the wine. And on this Passion Week, we want to just thank him. We want to remember his death. We want to honor him and praise him and thank him for that, because all that we have in Christ now has been provided for us because of his sacrificial death, because of the cross. The cross is basically a metaphor, you know, for his sacrifice, for his gift of redemption to us and what he's done. He experienced that for us. He went to the cross so that we could forgive. He went to the cross so that we could partake in thirst of the living water. He went to the cross to deliver us from a life of grief, an eternity of anguish. And if you have not made your decision to commit your life to Jesus Christ, I encourage you, consider that. I encourage you to do that tonight, today. The Bible says today is the accepted day, the day of salvation. And so let's take up the elements, let's take up the bread first, and let's pray. Father, we're so grateful and thankful that you sent your Son, that you came in the person of your Son, that you might go to a cross, that you might pour out your life, that you might take our sin upon you, you might take our punishment, the punishment that we so justly deserve, that you would take our everlasting judgment upon yourself. That as Paul says, you would actually become sin for us. So Lord, we want to thank you for taking our place. And in exchange for that, Lord, giving us your Spirit, giving us eternal life, giving us a new life. And Father, I pray for anyone out there that might be listening tonight, and that you'd help them to make that decision. To realize, Lord, they truly do need you in their lives. We thank you, Lord, that the cross, when we are faced with it in any way, there's a revelation comes to us, a revelation of how needy we are. And it's a revelation also, too, of grace of how good you are. And so, Lord, we thank you for all that you've done as we celebrate and remember, Lord, your death upon the cross. And celebrate this gift of redemption, this gift of eternal life, so freely given, but Lord, so difficultly won for us. So we honor you tonight, and we thank you. And Lord, we partake together of this bread. and with the juice in your hand. Lord, we know this juice represents, Lord, your blood, your lifeblood that was poured out. And the scripture reminds us that without the shedding of blood, there's no remission. There's no forgiveness of sins. So we thank you, Lord, for this great gift that we can be forgiven. And dear Lord, as we also come to the table tonight to thank you that if there is some area or issue of our lives that's bound up with bitterness or unforgiveness, Lord, we know that we can forgive because you have forgiven us. And you grant to us, Lord, this grace to release, Lord, anyone or any particular event that has maybe so wounded us or hurt us. We thank you for the blessed freedom that we can experience as we just, Lord, open our lives to you and say, Lord, sometimes we have to say, Lord, we don't want to forgive, or maybe we can't forgive. Yet we thank you that you can forgive through us. And so we ask you to do that. Lord, wash us, we pray. Forgive us for any of our moral failures, any of our sins, anything that has grieved your heart, anything that has broken fellowship. So, Lord, we drink this and we say thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us drink. Well, the Lord bless you. We ask you to join us again this Sunday for Resurrection Day, Easter service, and we will see you then. God bless.